فضاء لا انتهاء له وشمس تنير بحسبة.
وللأولياء الصالحين رضوان الله أجمعين. Moving on to chapter number 7 of Kitab al-Iman, inshallah ta'ala, we will be covering a very important hadith today. In fact, a number of scholars, including Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, and also Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qirwani rahimahullah, who was a very famous Maliki scholar who passed away in 386 Hijri, almost 1000 years ago, basically, this great scholar. He said that the whole of Islamic manners and ahklaaq evolves around four main hadiths, and one of them four hadiths is the hadith that we are going to be studying today, inshallah ta'ala. So you can imagine how important this hadith is. From the thousands and thousands of hadiths that we have, this is one of the four which are the foundations of the manners and ahklaaq of Islam. And if we were to really study this and to implement this into our lives, wallahi, it could change our lives forever. But it is very unfortunate that many of us are seeking Islamic knowledge, but we are only seeking it as a form of storing it in our mind, but we have no impact on it whatsoever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not test you on your day off, when you are completely free, when you got nothing to do, but rather it will be at a time when you are really busy, when you are angry, when you are in an argument, or in these kind of situations. That is the time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test you with your akhlaq, with your manners and your attitude. The only reason why I'm mentioning is this because many people who learn hadith, but they only apply it when it suits them. When it is befitting them, then they'll apply the hadith. So this is a wrong attitude of a person who learns a hadith. It's a wrong attitude of a Muslim. They should apply the hadith throughout their life, in every occasion, in every time. And this is how we do justice to the hadith. If we only take the hadith and we apply it to only the weekend, or we only apply it when we are with our family, and when we go outside, we don't apply the hadith anymore. That is not justice to the hadith. That is not justice to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And this is the main reason of why the Muslims today, even though the knowledge is available to them and they might even know the hadith, why is it that they're still lacking in manners and akhlaq? The ulama explained that there are two levels with who you will be tested with in terms of your attitude, your behavior and akhlaq. Number one is with those people who are close to you. How is your behavior with the household members of your family? How is your behavior with your wife? And similarly for the wife, does she even know how to talk to the husband? Does she have respect for the husband? So she might know the hadith, but in terms of applying it, she might not be applying it, and for that reason, she's having many problems in her marriage. And similarly with a male as well, he might know the hadith, but because he's not applying the knowledge to himself, he's having issues in his marriage as well. Inshallah ta'ala, when we do get time, we will go into the rights of the wife and in regards to the rights of the husband as well. This is very important for the people to know, because if they do not know the rights of each other, then how are they going to fulfill them rights? So the first thing is to have that knowledge and then to apply that knowledge. So inshallah, maybe in the next lesson we will try to go into the rights of the wife and the rights of the husband, and then in relation to the same hadith that we are going to be studying, the rights of the friends and the companions. So starting off with the title of the hadith, Babun min al-imani an yuhibba li akhihi ma yuhibbu li nafsihi. To love for your brother what you would love for yourself is part of iman. So it is mentioned in the chain, it has been narrated to us, haddathana musaddadun qal haddathana yahya an shu'bata an qatadata an anas radiyallahu anhu an nabiy sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وعن حسين المعلم قال حدثنا قتادة عن أنس رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال. So this famous narration has been narrated to us by Anas رضي الله عنه, and I'll just briefly mention about this famous Sahabi. Anas ibn Malik رضي الله عنه is narrated in total 2,286 hadith, and he is the third highly ranked Sahabi to have narrated the most hadith. Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu was born 10 years before the Hijrat actually took place, and he was from the tribe of Banu Khazraj in Medina, and his mother's name was Umme Sulaim. She was from the tribe of Banu Najjar. His father's name was Malik ibn Nadr, and he was also from the same tribe. It is mentioned that after the father of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu, he passed away, and he died as a non-Muslim. So his mother remarried to a new convert, to a new revert, and his name was Abu Talha ibn Sabit radiallahu anhu. It has also been mentioned that his mother took him to the Prophet ﷺ at a very young age, and he served the Prophet ﷺ for many years. It was at this time when the Prophet ﷺ made a very special dua for Anas radiallahu anhu. He made a dua for him for four things. Number one is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase him in his wealth. Number two is to increase him with his children. And number three is that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase him with his life. And number four is that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him from the Ahli Jannah. So Anas radiallahu anhu, he got to see three of those things out of the four which the Prophet ﷺ had done a special dua for. Later on, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, in the time of Hazrat Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu, he became a governor over Basra, and then later on became a governor over Damascus as well. So he was very rich and he became very wealthy. So that was the first dua of the Prophet ﷺ which came true in his lifetime. The other dua which the Prophet ﷺ did for him was for a lot of children, and it has been mentioned that Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, subhanallah, he had 120 children and grandchildren included, subhanallah. So he had so many children and grandchildren. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with 120. So that is something which he saw in his lifetime as well. And the third thing was when the Prophet ﷺ did a dua for his long life, it is mentioned that he lived for 103 years, and he was the last Sahabi to die in Basra. Now many people think that Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu was actually the last Sahabi to die, but the reality is that he was not the last Sahabi. There was actually another Sahabi by the name of Abu Tufail Amr ibn Wasila al-Laysi radiallahu anhu. Now he was the Sahabi who outlived every single Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is mentioned by Ibn Asakir rahimahullah. He mentions a narration in Tariq Medina, Damishq. He mentioned that the last one to die from all the Sahabas of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the face of this earth is Amir Abu Tufail ibn Wathila. And he used to say that no one is left on the face of this earth who can say that I saw the Prophet ﷺ except me. And he died in Makkah in 100 Hijri. This is a narration which has been mentioned by Ibn Asakir rahimahullah, and also Ibn Hibban has quoted a similar narration as well. Okay, so now moving on to the actual narration, it is mentioned by Anas radiallahu anhu, he narrates, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. It is mentioned that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that none of you believe until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. So subhanallah, inshallah, we will be looking at the spiritual side of this hadith and also the different levels of what has been mentioned by the ulama. Now the first thing to be pointed out in the wording of this hadith is that the Prophet ﷺ chose to use the word ayyuhibba, that he loves for his brother. The Prophet ﷺ didn't use the word yu'ti, that he gives his brother. Which goes to show a very important point which the ulama have mentioned, is about two things, that there is two types of love. One is a love which is ikhtiyari, that you have a choice. You have a choice of this love, whether you want to love this particular person or not. The other type of love is the tab'i, by nature of the love, like for example the love between the father and the son or the mother. This is something which is tab'i, it is something which is natural. So when you are giving a gift to someone that you love, or you are advising someone that you love, then this is something by nature which a person does. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that you need to do the same for someone who you don't know, but he is your Muslim brother. Now many times when we advise our brothers, sometimes they take it the wrong way. And sometimes when the sisters are advising the other sisters about hijab or any other thing, then they could take it offensive. So the best way really, which by experience, which I would mention, is before you go on to giving someone advice, mention this hadith to them. Say that I would only wish for you what I would wish for myself. And I would wish that someone had told me this, what I'm going to tell you. So please don't mind what I'm going to tell you. So if you were to start your conversation in this manner, then the Muslim brother or the Muslim sister will know that you are sincere in your advice and you are truthful. It has been mentioned that there are three stages of how you would wish for your brother what you would wish for yourself. Number one thing which the ulama have mentioned is that it must be something which you are free from in terms of any kind of jealousy, any kind of evil or envy. And it must be pure ikhlas, that it is only being said or it is only being done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is number one. Number two is that the second level is to say a good advice. So the way you would wish your brother what you would wish for yourself is by nasihat, by advice. So helping them by advice through the help of the tongue, second level. The higher level than this is where you would physically go and help them by action. For example, someone has broken down and they have never changed the tire before and they maybe do not know how to do so. So one level would be that you advise them of how to change the tire. The higher level would be that you actually change the tire for them. So this is the higher level where you are physically doing it yourself for them. So these are the three stages which have been mentioned that you would wish for your brother what you would wish for yourself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to reach on the highest level and to help our brothers and sisters by sincere advice, by ikhlas, and by physically helping them if there is a need to do so. Now just to understand the actual text of the hadith, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لا يؤمن أهدكم, none of you believes until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. Now does this actually mean that a person is not a believer until he actually does this? Because the reality is all the Muslims, they believe in whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says and whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. But not everyone has this quality of loving for others what he would love for himself. So does this mean that these people who don't have this quality are not Muslims, they're not believers? Then the answer is this does not mean that. Now in the Arabic language, there are several types of how to say no. There are several types of no. Like la, it has different types. So there's la jinsiya, there's la kamila. So there's different types. Whereas in the English language is only one type of no. Because the Arabic language is far more broader, it's far more intense. So when the Prophet ﷺ is saying la yu'minu, that none of you believes, he's not actually saying none of you actually believes. What the correct translation would be, none of you truly believes. And this is the way the Prophet ﷺ generally used to talk in many hadiths. It has been said, for example, the Prophet ﷺ said la yadkhulul jannata qattatun, that a slanderer will not enter into paradise. Okay, so what does this mean? So a Muslim who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he happened to have fallen into this sin of slandering, will he not go into paradise now? The answer is yes, he will go into paradise, but after he's been punished. So the hadith does not mean that he will never go into paradise, he will go after his punishment. Similarly is la yadkhulul jannata qati'un. Similarly here, the la, the no here, is a different type of a no, which gives the meaning of incompleteness. In another hadith, similarly, the Prophet ﷺ said, La salata illa bil fatiyat al kitab. The very famous narration, there is no salah without Surah Fatiha. So this is the incorrect translation for the hadith. The correct translation of this hadith would be, the salah is not complete without Surah Fatiha. That's the correct translation. You will not say there is no salah without Surah Fatiha. You will say the salah is incomplete. So the la is again being used in several hadiths, just like in this hadith لا يؤمن أحدكم, that none of you is a true believer until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. Okay, going on to some shuruhat of this, the ulama have mentioned that there are two levels of this hadith. The first level is that you would wish for your brother exactly what you would wish for yourself. This is the first level. And the example of this is the example when Abu Zar radiallahu anhu, he wanted to become a governor. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he saw some weakness in him to take this role on as a governor. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, I love for you what I would love for myself. So don't be in charge of two things. Number one is a group of more than two people. And number two is that don't be in charge of the orphan's wealth. So this is something which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw in him as a weakness. And he didn't want the people to take advantage over him of his good character. An example of this, of how we can really apply this, and there are many examples, and I'll just mention a few. One is that you see your Muslim brother or your sister who is starting a business. However, it happens to be that the business partner this brother has chosen is someone who is going to con him. So now you advise your brother that this person is so and so, he has conned many people before, stay away from this person. So you advise him just like you would want to be advised yourself. Another example is that you see someone who's not reading their salah correctly. Maybe they are making some mistakes about certain positions. Maybe a sister does not know how certain positions should be at the time of salah. A very famous example is what we see very common in the Jummah prayers, when there are many brothers who have on jeans without any belts, and it is like the pants are coming off. And what happens is when these brothers, when they go into sajda, their back is exposed. Now what is the ruling for this? The ruling is that their namaz is immediately broken, because this is the satr. When your back is being exposed, this is the satr, and it immediately breaks your salah. So a brother who sees this happening, he must advise his brother, and he must tell him that your salah is invalidated because of this reason. So this is the lower level of how you would advise your brother. The higher level than this, which the ulama have mentioned, is what you would wish for your brother more than what you would wish for yourself. An example of when you would love more for your brother than what you would love for yourself is the famous story of Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah. It is mentioned that Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah once happened to have had rats in his house. So he was really worried on how he can get rid of this. Somebody gave him some advice and told him that, why don't you buy a cat? Because the cats, they normally chase off the rats, so you will be free from this problem. So Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah, when he took this advice from him, he thought about it. Now, before going any further, what would be my response and what would be your response if we were to be given this advice? We would, without any kind of hesitation, without any further time being delayed, we want to get rid of these rats. So we will immediately go and buy a cat so we can get rid of them, we can get rid of the problem. But what Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah, he thought about, he thought, well, if the cats come to my house and the rats run away, where are the rats going to run? They're going to go to the next door neighbor's house. They're going to go to my neighbor's house. So he refused the idea of buying the cat, because simply that it's going to harm his neighbors. So this is an example of to love for your brother more than what you would love for yourself. So subhanallah, we should also try to implement these kind of incidents into our life as well. Another famous example which can be said from the books of hadith is the famous incident which took place from the Muhajirin. When the Muhajirin, the immigrants, when they heard about Islam, they left all their families, they left their businesses, they left everything. Just like me and you, we have so much responsibilities, and we have lands, we have houses, we got families. They left everything for the sake of Islam. everything. And they came to Medina. They came to Medina. Now they didn't have nothing. They didn't have no businesses. What? How are they going to live? But only for the sake of Islam they came, because the true Prophet has come. So they came running to Medina. Now at that time the Prophet ﷺ paired them up with the Ansar. So the Ansar are those who are from Medina, and the Muhajireen are referring to those who came from outside Medina. So they might have come from Persia, they might have come from different parts of the world when they had heard about the coming of the Prophet ﷺ. One of the pairs which the Prophet ﷺ made was of Sa'd ibn Rabi'a radiallahu anhu, who was one of the Ansar, and the Muhajir that had come to him was Abdul Rahman bin Auf radiallahu anhu. So Sa'd radiallahu anhu, he said to Abdul Rahman bin Auf that I have two houses, you pick one of them and I'll keep the other one. So subhanallah, he gave him an option of which one to choose from. He didn't choose one himself and gave him the other one. So here Sa'd radiallahu anhu has gone to the higher level where he is wishing for his brother more than what he wishes for himself. So subhanallah, this is the example of what I wanted to mention of this waqia, that he gave him the better option more than what he would wish for himself. And then he went on to say that I have two businesses, you can choose which one you want from the two. And he then went on to mention that I have a family, you can choose a wife for yourself. The question is that where did all this love come from between these two sahabas? Because the other sahabi was a complete stranger to him, and he didn't even know him, he didn't even recognize him. How is it that he's offering him half of his business? How is it that he is offering him one of his houses? So the answer is that the ultimate love was only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Muslim Brotherhood. Only for that sake, because he knew that my brother is in need. So he helped him to every bit that he could. Not only that, he gave him the better option as well. Unfortunately, this is something which we do not see in this time and age. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to bring this time again in the Ummah. Okay, inshallah, we'll leave it till then. Inshallah, in the next lesson, we will be looking at the rights of the husband and wife and the rights of the companions and friendship. Inshallah ta'ala. وما علينا إلا البلاء. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.